A very good afternoon and welcome to the midday news on Rajya Sabha television. My name is Aishwarya and these are the headlines. India and Indonesia agreed to upgrade ties to comprehensive strategic partnership, signed 15 MOUs including a one on defence cooperation. Efforts to increase bilateral trade to $50 billion by 2025 to be doubled. Binary election to three Rajya Sabha seats from Kerala to be held on 21st of June. Polls as the sitting members P.J. Kurian, John Abraham, C.P. Narayanan due to retire in July. Banking services crippled as nearly 10 lakh employees of 21 public sector banks, among others, strike protesting the meager 22% wage hike. Two-day strike being organized by nine bank unions. Delhi court gives a protection to former finance minister P. Chidambaram for arrest in connection with the ASL Max's money laundering case. Asks him to appear before Enforcement Directorate on 5th of June. Directs agency against any coercive action. And Israel denies Palestinian claims of ceasefire today, strikes 25 more Hamas sites overnight after rocket fire from Gaza Strip. United Nations meet today at the request of US to discuss the matter. First up, all the news on Prime Minister Narendra Modi's visit to Indonesia. Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Indonesian President Joko Widodo held a delegation-level talks in Jakarta today, and the two leaders discussed ways to enhance bilateral cooperation in the areas of maritime security, trade and commerce, regional connectivity and anti-terrorism measures. 15 MOUs were signed between the two sides with a focus on defence cooperation. The MOUs include 9 government-to-government and 6 business-to-business. An announcement to open CII's first overseas office in Jakarta was also made. The two leaders made a joint press conference in which Prime Minister Narendra Modi said that the two sides have decided to enhance ties to comprehensive strategic partnership. The Prime Minister also lauded Indonesia's positive contribution to the ASEAN grouping. The Prime Minister said that India-ASEAN partnership is an important power that can become a guarantee of peace not only in the Indo-Pacific region, but also beyond it.
हमारे बीच हुए समझौतों से हमारे द्विपक्षीय संबंधों को और बेहतर बनाने में सहायता मिलेगी। मुझे प्रसन्नता है कि हमने अपनी साझेदारी को कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव स्ट्रेटेजिक पार्टनरशिप के रूप में अपग्रेड करने का एक महत्वपूर्ण निर्णय लिया है। हम वर्ष 2025 तक द्विपक्षीय व्यापार को $50 बिलियन के स्तर तक ले जाने के लिए अपने प्रयास दोगुने करेंगे। हाल में हुए आतंकी हमलों में इंडोनेशिया के निर्दोष लोगों के मारे जाने का मुझे गहरा दुख है। भारत इस प्रकार के हमलों की कड़ी निंदा करता है। इस मुश्किल समय में भारत इंडोनेशिया के साथ मजबूती के साथ खड़ा है। इस प्रकार की त्रासद घटनाएं यह संदेश देती हैं कि आतंकवाद से लड़ने के लिए विश्व स्तर पर मिलजुल कर किए जा रहे प्रयासों में और अधिक गति लाने की समय की मांग है। इंडिया आसियान पार्टनरशिप एक ऐसी शक्ति है जो इंडो पैसिफिक क्षेत्र में तथा उससे परे भी शांति और साझा उन्नति के लिए गारंटी बन सकती है। हम आसियान में इंडोनेशिया की सकारात्मक भूमिका को बहुत ही महत्व देते हैं, साथ ही व्यापक क्षेत्रीय सहयोग एवं एकीकरण के लिए एसोसिएशन के प्रयास भी एक उदाहरण और प्रेरणा है।
Well, Prime Minister Modi today began his packed schedule for the day in Indonesia by paying tribute at the iconic Kalibata Heroes Cemetery in Jakarta, where he laid a wreath. The Kalibata National Heroes Cemetery, located in southern Jakarta, is a military cemetery which contains the graves of prominent Indonesian soldiers and generals, including resistance heroes who died during the Second World War. It also consists of graves of Japanese soldiers along with Indonesian soldiers who died while fighting for Indonesia's independence in the mid-1940s. Many prominent leaders visiting Indonesia have visited the monument, such as the Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe, Turkish President Recep Erdogan, and South Korean President Moon Jae-in, to name a few. Most recently, Chinese Premier Li Keqiang had also paid a visit to Kalibata National Heroes Cemetery earlier this month. And this is Prime Minister Narendra Modi's maiden visit to Indonesia, and earlier in the day, he was accorded a ceremonial guard of honor at the Istana Merdeka, which is one of the 6 presidential palaces in Indonesia. Prime Minister Modi held one-on-one veranda talks with Indonesian President Joko Widodo. India and Indonesia have shared cordial bilateral relations and close cultural ties. India and Indonesia are among the largest democracies in the world. Both are member states of the G20, the E7 countries, the NAM, as well as the United Nations. Indonesia is one of India's closest maritime neighbors, as well as Indonesia is India's largest trading partner and the largest economy in the ASEAN. India has invested $15 billion in the Indonesia's economy, and the Prime Minister's visit is aimed to further boost India's Act East policy. And Jakarta's famous annual kite festival had a special guest this time. Prime Minister Narendra Modi, along with Indonesian President Joko Widodo, inaugurated the festival today. Now, the festival this time is themed on Hindu mythology. Images of kites depicting stories from the epics of Ramayana and Mahabharata are part of the festival. The Kite Festival of Jakarta has been one of the oldest and the most famous long-standing festivals of Indonesia. Participants from across the country are competing to showcase their unique kite creations. The festival is being jointly organized by the Museum Layang Layang of Jakarta and the Kite Museum of Ahmedabad. Well, the Prime Minister and the Indonesian President also visited the Istiqlal Mosque in Jakarta. Right, let's get a perspective on the story. Akhilesh Suman is now joining us from the newsroom. Akhilesh, Prime Minister Modi's visit in, you know, we are seeing unfolding a strong reaffirmation of our growing ties with the Southeast Asia. Now, India and Indonesia have agreed to today upgrade their ties to the comprehensive strategic partnership, and they've also signed 15 agreements. So tell us more.
Other than these 15 agreements, the 3 announcements have also been made. And one of the major of these announcements is the opening of CII in Indonesia, Jakarta, Indonesian capital of Jakarta. And this is the first overseas office of CII. You can understand that what importance India and Indonesia are giving to each other in terms of business. And the very place that $50 billion trade should be there by 2025 shows that India and Indonesia are going closer than expected, because we also have a relationship with many other countries in the ASEAN region, but such a big target is only remarkable.
Yes.
And you know that importance of this understanding, and this you see that a comprehensive strategic partnership is also with a view that Indonesia is one of the major countries in Indo-Pacific region. It is conglomeration of many islands in the whole region. It is on the mouth of South China Sea and Malacca Strait, and yes, also that it is the biggest Muslim population in the world, India being the second largest Muslim population in the world. So given all these criteria in mind, Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Indonesian President decided to go into much more deeper relationship than it was. And you know that the very signing of defense cooperation, if you see the whole transcript of defense cooperation, you will see that it is all comprehensive, right? From joint defense production to air, naval and army exchanges to sharing of understanding, intelligence, everything is there in that defense cooperation. It is, I think, one of the biggest defense cooperations between India and the whole ASEAN region. Yes. Another aspect I will try to focus is that relationship in pharma sector. Yes. India's pharma sector is considered to be very strong, and Indonesia wants to take advantage of Indian pharma sectors, and also it wants to take advantage of India's expertise in whole medical sector equipment, understanding, knowledge of medical, everything they want to have an understanding with India. So it is the second major. And the third, you know that it is a show and display of cultural bonhomie between the two countries. Yes. Because India being the largest Muslim population, and if it is showing the kite festival with a specific theme of Ramayana, it shows how diverse culture Indonesia is and how it is respecting India's sentiment, given the fact that our Western neighbor, that is Pakistan, is also always try to create a bonhomie among the world on the basis of the religion. So Indonesia has given a very good signal that yes, we respect India because of diversity, and we also follow the diversity. And the whole Indonesian culture, you know, that is based on both Hindu mythological traditions, Buddhist mythological traditions, and also on Islamic traditions. So it is a big messaging for the whole world about the whole region, and also to our adversaries in the Western side.
Yes, absolutely. Sorry. And also very important, Akhilesh, was Prime Minister, coining that term Sagar, where he said under India's Act East policy, we have Sagar, which is security and growth for all in the region. Also, that is very significant. Mimrata, thank you so much for all those updates there on that story. And in midday news, we'll take a very short break here. We'll be back with more news on the other side. Stay tuned.
Tales that inspire. Stories of social change. A salute to diversity. Promoting public discourse. Events that motivate. Inspiring the innovative spirit. Watch Rajya Sabha television documentaries.
Welcome back after the break. The Election Commission has announced a schedule for the biennial elections to Rajya Sabha from Kerala. The election schedule has been announced due to the retirement of three sitting members on 1st of July this year. The retiring members are P.J. Kurian, Joy Abraham and C.P. Narayanan. As per the schedule, the notification for the polls will be issued on 4th of June. And the last date for making nominations is 11th of June. The scrutiny will take place the next day, and 14th of June is the last date for the withdrawal of nominations. Polling takes place on 21st of June, and the counting will take place on the same day. Meanwhile, re-polling is being held today in 123 polling stations across three parliamentary constituencies of Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra and Nagaland. The re-poll that began at 7 this morning will end at 6 p.m. today. Repolling is being held in 73 polling stations in Uttar Pradesh's Kairana, 49 polling stations in Maharashtra's Bhandara Gondia, and one polling station in Nagaland. The Election Commission had on Tuesday announced repolling in these polling stations after VVPAT machines developed snags during Lok Sabha bypolls. Bypolls were held for 4 Lok Sabha and 10 Assembly seats on Monday. Over 11% of the 10,300 VVPAT machines across the 10 states had developed faults and they had to be replaced. On to some other news, banking activities in public sector banks across the country have been interrupted as employees are on a 2-day nationwide strike. Nearly 10 lakh bank employees are protesting against a nominal 2% wage hike offered by the Indian Banks Association, and there are reports coming of ATM services being hit at some places. However, operations in private banks like the ICICI Bank, HDFC Bank, Axis Bank are almost normal, barring few activities including check clearances. And after 16 days of a continuous hike, fuel prices witnessed a slight drop by 1 paise per litre today. Earlier in the morning, the Indian Oil Corporation had announced a reduction in petrol and diesel prices by 60 paise and 56 paise each per litre in Delhi. The reduction in price was revised as IOC officials said that a clerical error by their officials had led to the earlier figure. The petrol prices went down not by 60 paise in Delhi and 59 paise in Mumbai, but only by 1 paise in the national capital. Petrol now is priced at 78.42 rupees per litre and diesel 69.3 rupees per litre. Former Union Minister P. Chidambaram was granted interim protection from arrest in connection with the ASL Max's money laundering case today. Chidambaram had filed an anticipatory bail plea in Delhi's Patiala House Court. He has been asked to appear before the Enforcement Directorate on 5th of June. The court also directed the ED to not take any coercive action against Chidambaram till then. Chidambaram pleaded that all the evidence in the matter is documentary in nature.
कोर्ट ने तो केवल यही कहा है कि 5 तारीख को नोटिस दिया है और साथ में कहा है कि आप ईडी के साथ कोऑपरेट करो और हमने आश्वासन दिया है कि जब जब ईडी हमें बुलाएगी तो हम वहां जाएंगे तारीख पे.
Big story coming in from New Delhi, where a massive fire that broke out in a rubber godown in Malviya Nagar yesterday evening is yet to be doused. Earlier today, Indian Air Force launched a Mi-17 helicopter attached with a Bambi bucket in order to extinguish the fire. 40 tenders were rushed to the spot to no avail last night. No casualty, thankfully, has been reported in the fire breakout. A truck loaded with the rubber material parked near the godown had caught fire, which rapidly spread due to strong winds last night. The area was quickly evacuated. On to some other news. Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu today visited Dr. Ambedkar Museum in the national capital. Paying a floral tribute to Dr. Ambedkar, the Vice President praised the museum that was built to keep Ambedkar's memory alive. Naidu further added that Ambedkar was a pioneer in giving proper guidance and direction to the nation after independence. The Vice President also congratulated the architects for completing the project on time. The museum consists of 27 exhibits which depict and display the life and the contributions of Dr. Ambedkar.
Almost a live museum to make the younger generation understand the life and the important contribution he has made for the country and its for social advancement. This work is beautifully done. Every aspect of his life from the beginning to the end was depicted in such a proper manner so as to make the coming generations to know and understand by visiting this museum the life and teachings and preachings of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar.
On to our special report now. The NDA government introduced the Beti Bachao Beti Padhao scheme in 2015 to strictly enforce the law against female feticide and gender discrimination. So far, 640 districts of the country have been added to the scheme. But to get to know the entire extent of improvement in situation, the Rajya Sabha team visited Sonipat in Haryana, which was selected in the year 2015, where female feticide and gender discrimination was common.
डॉक्टर साहब, हमारे गांव में लड़कियां इतनी कम क्यों हैं?
अरे वाह मैडम, टेस्ट कराने आप आई हैं और सवाल भी आप ही कर रही हैं। ये सब आप लोगों की वजह से तो होता है।
मतलब?
खैर छोड़िए इन सब बातों को, तीर निशाने पर लगा ही नहीं।
क्या?
लड़की है।
Meet Meera. We are not revealing her face and identity as per her request. Meera is one of those brave and progressive women who support the local administration to catch the criminals who eliminate and remove female fetuses. Though sex determination tests are banned under the Preconception and Prenatal Diagnostic Techniques Prohibition of Sex Selection Act 2003, commonly called the PCPNDT Act, it continues to thrive in the dark alleys of small towns. Asha is a vigilant whose mission is to bring these culprits to the book. A committed supporter of child rights, she believes in treating both girls and boys equally. She will deliver her second child soon.
मेरी एक ढाई साल की बेटी है और अगर मेरे को दूसरी भी बेटी होती है तो मैं उसको भी उतना ही प्यार दूंगी जितना मैं अपनी पहली बेटी को देती हूँ। मेरे लिए लड़का और लड़की में कोई फ़र्क नहीं है और मैं उन महिलाओं को भी यही बताना चाहती हूँ कि लड़का लड़की में फ़र्क ना करे।
Haryana has one of the worst sex ratios in the country. To redeem its reputation, it has now taken Beti Bachao Beti Padhao campaign in a mission mode. In the last 3 years, the state police has booked 590 violators under the PNDT and MTP Act.
हमने इससे पहले entire 3 साल में हम मैंने 40 रेड लगाई total 46 रेड 34 है हमारी PNDT की और 12 है MTP की. जिसमें 36 है उसमें 24 जो रेड हैं वो आउट ऑफ स्टेट हैं और आउट ऑफ स्टेट सारी ही सारी हमारी सक्सेसफुल रेड रही।
इनिशियली द 100 वर्स्ट अफेक्टेड डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स इन द कंट्री केम अंडर द एम्बिट ऑफ दिस स्कीम आउट ऑफ व्हिच 87 डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स हैड अ सेक्स रेशियो लेस देन 918. 8 districts where the sex ratio was dropping below 918 and 5 districts where the sex ratio was above 918. These 5 districts were chosen to become the harbinger of hope for the rest. The state of Haryana has 12 of the worst affected districts including Sonipat.
Aaj bhi hamare desh mein 1000 balak paida ho to uske samne 1000 बालिकाएं भी पैदा होनी चाहिए। मैं जरा माताओं से पूछ रहा हूं, अगर बेटी पैदा नहीं होगी तो बहू कहां से लाओगे? अगर बहू पढ़ी लिखी चाहती है तो बेटी को भी पढ़ाना ये हमारी जिम्मेवारी बनती है।
The element of education was added to the scheme to ensure its success, though survival of the girl child was the primary objective. The government banned all prenatal diagnostic tests to achieve this objective. Strict punishment under the PNDT Act 1996 was envisaged. All offences under the Act are cognizable, non-bailable and non-compoundable under Section 27. It includes 3 to 5 years jail term and a fine of 15,000 for the spouses, doctor and lab assistant who use ultrasound or ultrasonography for sex determination. But unfortunately, the law failed to deter the culprit, especially in the states of Haryana, Rajasthan and Punjab. The sex ratio in 1951 was 983 per 1000 males. It reduced to 945 in the next 40 years. Even the PNDT Act failed to stem this fall. In 2001, it fell to 927. In 2011, there were just 918 girls per 1000 boys.
Institutional dilkyo ke bachchi ko marna hospital mein is more difficult than killing her jab dai paida karwati hai. तो इसलिए इंस्टीट्यूशनल डिलीवरीज बिकेम कंपल्सरी. सेकंड, पीसीपी एंड डीटी एक्ट में बहुत तगड़ी नज़र रखा गया, आई वांट अ लला लली बोर्ड इन विच कितनी लड़कियां हैं इस गांव में और कितने लड़के.
To implement the scheme at the grassroots, the government mobilized the services of Anganwadi and Asha workers. These workers go door to door and educate pregnant women against such tests and female feticide. This critical campaign is now gaining traction. In 2014, in Sonipat, there were just 830 girls against 1,000 boys. Post Beti Bachao Beti Padhao campaign in 2015, it rose to 867 girls per 1,000 boys. In 2016, it rose to 902. In 2017, it was 937. And till April 2018, it has touched 947 girls per 1,000 boys. It is believed that these figures will continue to rise in the future. It goes on to prove that any successful implementation of the law needs grassroots support, which happened in this case.
अब ज़्यादातर परिवार पढ़े लिखे हो गए हैं, अब सबकी सोच बदल गई है और बेटी हर जगह सर्विस करती है, किसी भी चीज़ में पीछे नहीं है.
बेटी पाल्या बेटे पाछे, देख हम तो यही होना चाहिए. देख हाँ यही तो कहूँ आता है, कोशिश तो पूरी कर रहे हैं.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi recently praised the state's efforts in checking female feticide. According to him, Haryana has produced distinguished farmers, businessmen and brave soldiers. In such a distinguished state, female feticide cannot exist. Haryana has taken efforts to ensure female feticide does not happen. Beti Bachao Beti Padhao is a harbinger of hope, not just for Haryana but for the entire country. Anu Devan's report from Sonipat in Haryana for Rajya Sabha TV.
Our top international focus now. Israel has denied the ceasefire claims by Palestine as it struck 25 more Hamas strikes overnight after a barrage of rocket and mortar fire from the Gaza Strip. The exchange of fire raised the possibility of yet another war in the beleaguered Palestinian enclave, which would be the fourth since 2008. Now, Israel has targeted more than 60 military targets in the Gaza Strip over the last 24 hours, saying that some 70 rocket and mortars were fired into its territory throughout the day on Tuesday. Meanwhile, the United Nations Security Council will meet today to discuss the rocket attacks on Israel. The meeting will be held at the request of the United States, which wants the top UN body to strongly condemn the attacks from the Palestinian enclave. And that's it in this edition of Midday News. Thanks for watching.